It's become quite clear that our primary source of energy production needs to change. We've all seen the statistics and heard the reports.
This is all wrong.
A struggle for survival. Climate change is on fast forward.
If we are not able to reverse the present trend that is leading to a catastrophe in the world, we will be doomed.
It would be easy to beat you around the head with the science and the facts that have been established for decades, that our use of fossil fuels is causing the Earth to get warmer. This is not that video. This video addresses a more important question. How do we fix the situation we're in? How do we get from the current state of the world, where around 80% of power is generated from fossil fuels, to a world where we can support 8 billion people and still produce net zero emissions? And as investors, how can we put our dollars towards companies that are making them count? How are we going to facilitate this great energy transition? This video covers a few topics, all relating to one of the most pressing megatrends of our time, decarbonisation. The framework that we'll be operating on for this video is net zero by 2050. 2050 is an agreement between members of the United Nations targeting net zero greenhouse gas emissions by 2050. Net zero emissions refers to achieving an overall balance between greenhouse gas emissions produced and greenhouse gas emissions taken out of the atmosphere. Here's Gabby Herculano, CEO at sustainable investment firm iClima, to help explain.
Net zero is the point where we can cancel out any carbon emissions produced with sequestration. So it's that point where we're not making more harm.
Think of it like a set of scales. Producing greenhouse gas emissions tips the scales towards a rise in global emissions. We want to get those scales back into balance. The world would achieve net zero emissions if, for every kilogram of greenhouse gas that is emitted, a kilogram is also removed from the atmosphere. The problem is, at the moment, there's an elephant on the emissions side of the scale and a feather on the other.
So that path to net zero is a hard path, and that's why it's a 2050 goal, because to decarbonize companies in particular, for them to decarbonize their operations, you have to do a lot of things to clean up your scope 1, your scope 2, and the famous supply chain scope 3 emissions. So the big numbers.
We need to massively reduce our emissions and then offset the residual emissions that are unpreventable. Here's how we get there. A lot of the analysis we use in this video comes from the comprehensive breakdown of net zero by the International Energy Agency. The IEA is a collection of 31 member countries governed by energy ministers from these countries. In 2021, the IEA published extensive analysis called the 2050 Roadmap. You can read that report here. The IEA forecasts that by 2050, based on a trajectory with no mitigation measures, emissions will reach 52 gigatons of greenhouse gas every year. We'd need to fully offset that amount in order to get to a net zero scenario. The IEA expects that these offsets will come from the following sources. 28% will come from traditional renewable energy sources, such as solar, wind, and bioenergy. 22% will come from electrification of current fossil fuel-powered activities, like electric cars and building heating. 14% will come from carbon capture technology that removes greenhouse gases from the atmosphere. Another 14% will come from fuel shifts to alternative low-carbon solutions, like nuclear energy. 13% will come from avoided demand due to advances in technology, like more people working from home and behavioural changes. Finally, 10% will come from improvements in energy efficiency from appliances and technology. There is a lot of work to do and a lot of investment to put behind these initiatives. According to a report released in September 2020 by the Energy Transitions Commission, the additional investment required to achieve a zero carbon emissions economy by 2050 would be around $1 to $2 trillion per annum. That's comparable to investing the current gross domestic product of Italy into development of these solutions every year, or investing more than 10 times Elon Musk's net worth annually. To break down this massive energy transition and the accompanying options for investors, let's start with one of the largest decarbonisation trends, electric vehicles. Electric vehicles are a big deal in the 2050 framework because of the carbon footprint that internal combustion engines have. An ICE vehicle is powered by pistons that are moved by small explosions through the combination of fuel and air. The result of these explosions is significant carbon dioxide emissions. A typical passenger car spits out about 4.6 metric tons of carbon dioxide a year. Most of this comes from tailpipe emissions. In 2020 in the US, vehicles accounted for an astonishing 27% of greenhouse gas emissions. In comparison, electric vehicles have no tailpipe emissions. And combustion engines are really just a bad downstream hangover of the actual extraction and refinement of crude oil. Increasing the electrification of our road fleet won't just reduce the number of emissions from combustion, but also the amount of crude oil that needs to be dug up and refined. The EU is proposing to introduce laws effectively requiring all new cars sold from 2035 to be net zero emissions, meaning new car sales will be limited to electric and hydrogen powered vehicles. This proposal implies significant demand for EVs, as currently only 1% of cars on the road are electric. But it's a bit unclear how car manufacturers are going to meet that demand. Here's our senior investment strategist, Cam Gleeson, to give us a bit of a taste as to what the landscape for EVs look like in 2050.
Yeah, so the automotive industry is in a state of flux, and there are a number of dynamics at play. For example, the relationships between suppliers of key componentry, whether you're talking about raw battery materials or the battery makers, and the automotive manufacturers. Quite interesting because you've got those dedicated EV manufacturers like Tesla, like BYD, but then you've got those traditional auto manufacturers. And you know, typically some of the leaders like Volvo, like VW, might be selling around about 10% of their total car sales are dedicated electric vehicles. Now, you know, Volkswagen and Volvo are probably the most progressed in terms of shifting their business model from internal combustion engines to electrified transportation. But as to whether or not a traditional manufacturer like Ford will be one of the leaders in the coming decades, we have to wait and see.
But there is a flip side to all of this. Increased EVs on the road correlate to increased use of electricity. And if that electricity is generated via fossil fuels, then we're back to square one.
Once we reach sort of the period of 2040, we expect that electric vehicles will be consuming around about 15% of total electricity and perhaps up to 25% of total electricity by the time we hit 2050.
That's why it's important to think about the plumbing behind electric vehicles and a shift to clean energy. That's where solar power comes in. 21% of avoided emissions in 2050 are expected to come from the generation of solar and wind power. There's a good reason why it's such an important part of the energy mix in 2050. Let's put solar into perspective a little bit. Energy usage is measured primarily in watt hours. It tells you how long you can use an appliance for, depending on its wattage. For example, a 100 watt bulb running for an hour would use 100 watt hours, and an 1000 watt vacuum running for 1 hour would use 1000 watt hours, or 1 kilowatt hour. You can map carbon emissions to kilowatt hours. Imagine each ping pong ball represents 40 grams of carbon dioxide emissions. Using coal as fuel creates 1 kilo of emissions for every kilowatt hour produced. Natural gas plants produce around 400 grams, and solar power produces only 40 grams per kilowatt hour. That's 1/25 as much as a coal-fired plant. Fantastic news, but the concepts and ideas behind solar energy have been around for a long time. There have been two key roadblocks to its full adoption. First is cost. In the 1950s, solar panels were so expensive that they were only used in satellites. But economies of scale are a powerful thing. From 1976, each doubling of solar capacity has led to a 20.2% average decline in the price of solar panels. The cost per kilowatt figure has now declined by around 90% over the past decade. Solar panels are now the cheapest form of energy generation. So, if solar is so cheap, why does it only meet about 3% of global electricity demand? It's because of this graph. This is the duck curve.
The duck curve plots the gap between the electricity demand and the megawatts of solar produced during the day. So the more solar that gets added to the grid, the less demand for the fossil fuel base load installations take place. So year after year, that demand has decreased, and the shape is very much that shape of a duck, so therefore the name duck curve.
Imagine this is your energy usage throughout the day.
There's a problem, right?
Because you use most of your energy when it's dark and the sun isn't up. Energy consumption peaks in the evenings when people get home from work, turn on their lights, and watch television. So electricity grids are faced with huge changes in demand. During the day, they don't need to provide much energy because of solar. Then they have to ramp up production at night to compensate for the setting sun. And that's just not feasible for coal-fired plants, which are expensive and slow to turn on and off. We need to normalize this curve. Shift the additional solar energy here to the afternoon and evenings. There are a few ways to do this, and one of the biggest proposed solutions is energy storage. If we can store a portion of the energy generated at midday until night, then we can stop relying on fossil fuel generation for electricity.
And then, of course, we have the batteries, the short-duration batteries and the long-duration energy storage. So we can time shift. Let's charge the stationary batteries and the mobile batteries inside the electric vehicles, and then use the batteries inside the electric vehicles, which is called vehicles to grid. It's not a concept, it's here, and very big incumbent automakers are embracing that. Ford has their big lightning truck, the F-150, is a bidirectional truck that gives that ability to use it to the benefit of the grid when needed. So with that, you can time shift and you can charge all those batteries at different points, very decentralized, and use it to the benefit of the grid.
And this leads us nicely into the next section of this video. Storing electricity requires batteries, and batteries are created using energy transition metals. Electric vehicles and solar panels cannot exist without the materials needed to build them. That's where energy transition metals come in. Materials critical in contributing to net zero emissions by 2050. Here are the metals we're talking about more specifically. Lithium, nickel, cobalt, manganese, and graphite are all crucial to battery performance, longevity, and energy density. Rare earth elements are used to create permanent magnets that are vital in wind turbines and EV motors. Finally, electricity networks need a huge amount of copper and aluminium, with copper being a cornerstone for all electricity-related technologies. Unfortunately, digging up these materials is easier said than done. Increased demand for these metals pushes up prices, making them expensive to source. Price volatility in materials used in manufacturing adds risk to company supply chains. Even if these materials were cheap and stable in price, there's another problem. Production of these metals is often plagued with corruption, poor health and safety regulation, environmental damage, and child labor concerns. This represents further supply chain risk for companies like Tesla and battery manufacturers like CATL. But corporates are adjusting to these problems. For example, as the price of nickel skyrockets, battery manufacturers are investing in lithium iron phosphate, or LFP, solutions. This process is known as chemistry flexibility. Have a look at this graph. This shows the metallic content from selected battery solutions. Some are heavily dependent on cobalt or nickel, others are not. Chemistry flexibility helps companies substitute supply of certain materials if they become too expensive.
Battery makers try to optimize for performance and cost. Now, those two things can often come in conflict because, as we've seen in the past, for example, about 5 years ago, cobalt, one of the key ingredients to the most popular battery chemistry, which is currently in use, became very expensive. How do battery makers adapt? They typically will look to substitute or reduce the amount of that expensive material used and increase the other elements used in the battery chemistry.
For this reason, investors in green metals are better off looking to get exposure to a range of commodities instead of just a single one.
So you've got this sort of interesting dynamic where we don't necessarily know the particular outlook for a single battery material, but we know as a whole, the group is likely to see an increased demand and perhaps a more stable increase in demand as a group, as a whole, rather than thinking about a single material.
Nobody really knows how much cobalt or lithium is going to be needed in 2050 because battery chemistry is a fluid thing. Obtaining exposure to a selection of energy transition metals might be a better way to benefit from the tailwind. And that's it. Easier said than done, but the roadmap to 2050 is there. And with support from investors, corporates, and governments, it's achievable. We've only covered a few of the key solutions that will make a net zero emission target by 2050 possible. We haven't even touched on avoided emissions, which makes up 13% of IEA's expected breakdown for emissions reduction.
Potential avoided emissions is a very important concept. It is about moving us away from business as usual high emissions and replacing the way our economies run with much lower alternatives. And this delta is the potential avoided emissions.
Companies offering sustainable products like Beyond Meat and those helping facilitate work from home like Zoom are all important parts in reducing our overall carbon footprint. You can find out a bit more about these other solutions in the links we've put in the description of this video. It's also important to remember that as investors, we can help speed up this great energy transition collectively. So for those looking to invest in some of these solutions, you've come to the right place. We're Betashares, a fund manager that offers a wide range of ETFs. Across our range, we offer investment exposures to companies involved in the great energy transition. These include a broad decarbonisation ETF with the ticker Earth, an electric vehicle ETF with the ticker DRIV, a solar power ETF with the ticker TAN, and an energy transition metals ETF, ticker XMET. You can find all of these funds and many more at our website here. Thanks for watching. Let us know what you thought of this video in the comments, and we'll see you in the next one.